Welcome to Season 5 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore, Maryland. Our goal with this podcast is to bring scientific evidence and experience to shed light on critical health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Ready or not? Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call, and today our topic is how prepared states are for public health emergencies. Dr. Josh Sharfstein speaks to Dr. Nadine Gracia, president and CEO of Trust for America's Health, an organization that releases ratings and rankings of state readiness in a report called Ready or Not. The 2022 report has just come out. Let's listen.
Dr. Gracia, thanks so much for joining me on Public Health On Call to talk about the new report from Trust for America's Health called Ready or Not. My first question is, ready or not for what?
Well, thank you, Dr. Sharfstein, for the opportunity to be with you for your podcast today. So Ready or Not is Ready or Not about public health emergencies and whether we as a nation truly are ready for the broad scale of public health emergencies that can arise.
So we have been through a public health emergency. We're still in a public health emergency, according to the emergency declaration. And I think you'd find a lot of people saying that maybe we didn't do so well. Is this a report about pandemic preparedness?
That's a great question. So this report, which assesses states' level of preparedness to protect residents' health during an emergency, it really looks at an all-hazards approach. So this report is not specifically about the state's response to the COVID-19 pandemic. Emergencies can be a broad scale of areas such as weather-related emergencies like hurricanes and tornadoes, record heat, to also looking at other types of infectious disease outbreaks. And so what this report does is really look at an all-hazards preparedness approach to the vast array of public health emergencies.
So you set out to measure and really rank against each other a little bit, the states in their ability to be prepared for different public health emergencies. How do you do that? What do you assess about each state?
So the report, we use 10 performance indicators that really assess based on a subset of indicators from the National Health Security Preparedness Index, which has an even broader array of indicators looking at the nation's health security. What Ready or Not looks at is a subset of 10 indicators that are aligned to looking at some of the core foundational capabilities as it relates to emergency preparedness, things such as the ability to expand healthcare capacity during an emergency or expanding laboratory capacity during an emergency. And in assessing those 10 indicators, we then place states in three categories: high, middle, and low. In this year's report, 17 states plus the District of Columbia were placed into the high performance tier. There are 20 states in the middle performance tier and 13 states in the low performance tier.
Before we get to examples of states, which I do want to get to, tell me a little bit more about the kinds of things you asked about each state to decide which tier to put them in.
So it's really one, taking and looking at an assessment of, does a state, for example, have a plan in place to be able to surge their healthcare capacity during times of an emergency? So for example, having a nurse licensure compact in which a state is then able to have available nurses come across from other jurisdictions to be able to support the staffing needs in response to an emergency. It's looking at, for example, the number of employed workers who use paid time off and taking a one-month snapshot and assessing how much employed workers actually use paid time off, which is a helpful indicator then to also look at how to be able to control, for example, an infectious disease outbreak. It's also looking at factors such as accreditation and whether or not a state has public health accreditation as well as emergency management and preparedness accreditation.
I want to go back to the sick leave one that you mentioned, which is pretty interesting. You're not just talking about healthcare workers there, are you?
That's right. We're talking about those who are employed, whether or not they actually have access to and use paid time off. And we as a nation know that we have a dearth of access to paid sick leave as an example within that spectrum of paid time off. On average, only about 55% of employed workers actually use paid time off in a one-time snapshot. And that's important when we talk about emergencies, because especially, for example, if you have an infectious disease outbreak, ensuring that workers have the ability to stay home if they're sick care for a loved one if they're sick and be able to control the spread of infectious disease is a critical infection control measure. But we saw, as an example in this pandemic, far too many, especially low-income workers and workers of color, for example, who did not have access to paid sick leave.
In a way that makes their state less prepared.
That's right. And again, this is an issue that can be addressed certainly through lawmakers with regards to passing and looking at paid sick leave, which we have shown as both health evidence as well as economic evidence to support promoting health as well as controlling costs in the state. And it also helps businesses with regards to assuring that they have high productivity and being able to reduce spread, for example, of an infectious disease during an outbreak.
Got it. What is new this year? Is there anything that you added? Because I know you've been doing this report for a while. With the experience of the pandemic, understanding this is not just about pandemic preparedness, did the experience of the pandemic inform the measures that you use to judge the states?
Well, that's really important with regards to the indicators. There actually is a new indicator among that set of 10 that was introduced into this year's report. And that is what we call comprehensiveness of the public health system, looking at the percentage of the state population that is actually served by a comprehensive public health system. What do we mean by that? It's a public health system that is able to do the core foundational capabilities of public health, of assessment, surveillance, having a workforce, communications capacity, as well as policy implementation, and being able to do those assessments, assessing the needs of communities, being able to partner effectively and providing those basic public health services. As a nation, it's only about half of the population that actually is served by a comprehensive public health system. And we saw great variation across the states. And so that is certainly a call for action with regards to investing in the public health infrastructure and public health system to assure that everyone is served.
And how did you judge whether there was a comprehensive public health system in a particular place?
There's actually a survey that has gone to a sample of local health officials at local health departments that asked a set of 20 questions assessing those various capabilities. And then from there, a composite score is then prepared with regards to what percentage of the population is actually served by a comprehensive public health system.
Well, if the answer there was only about half of the population, sounds like we've got a ways to go. So before we get to the states that were the overachievers or the underachievers, how do you think the nation is doing? I mean, does this show that, like, by and large, we're ready, by and large, we're not ready? You know, the report's titled Ready or Not. So which is it?
So by and large, we would say progress has been made since we started this report in 2003. Areas such as laboratory capacity and looking at how to be able to surge in times of emergency, looking at the ability to have workforce surge capacity, for example, during emergencies. But we recognize that there are still some critical areas for the nation with regards to being ready for a whole host of the types of public health emergencies that we're describing. And a lot of that we can attribute to the chronic underfunding of public health, as well as the lack of investment in ensuring that communities are strong and resilient to those types of emergencies.
Dr. Gracia, what about the observation during the pandemic that disparities in health, but also disparities in access to safe working conditions, safe living conditions, access to food and housing, that really played a big role in who got sick? Is that part of your assessment for who's ready for an emergency, whether they're taking action against some of those underlying inequities?
Absolutely. You know, the pandemic not only exposed, but it has also exacerbated many of those health inequities, as well as social and economic inequities that have been longstanding. We've seen these types of inequities in even previous public health emergencies, and the pandemic really shone a light on those inequities. So a call for us and a key recommendation of our report is the need to actually address those broader social and economic conditions that can help to actually assure that everyone has the opportunity to be healthy and to assure that communities are stronger and more resilient during times of emergency as well as in non-emergency times. It means planning with communities and ensuring that community leaders have a voice in that emergency planning, but it's also investing in those broader social and economic conditions to assure that everyone has a fair and just opportunity for health and well-being.
All right, let's get to the March Madness for Ready or Not. Which were the states that did particularly well? Okay, just give me a couple examples.
So some examples of states that were in the high performance tier were states like Maryland and Virginia, where, for example, they had those nurse licensure compacts to be able to surge their workforce capacity. They increased the level of their state public health funding from the previous years. And so having that investment in public health, as well as having that laboratory surge capacity and being accredited, having accreditation in both public health and emergency management.
Got it. What about some states that have their work cut out for them?
So states that were in the low performance tier are states, for example, like the state of Kentucky and the state of Louisiana, where, for example, opportunities for areas of improvement may be in the state of Kentucky to have accreditation in public health and emergency management, or seeing declines in public health funding from the previous year. You know, an important point about this ranking and having the tiers with regards to the states is to know that every state, even those in the high performance tier, can do more to improve their emergency preparedness. And that we even saw in this year, there was more fluctuation with regards to the states and their placement in the various tiers, in part due to the introduction of a new indicator this year, as well as certainly what we've seen with regards to the pandemic and funding for the pandemic itself.
So there may be some people listening, because we have listeners around the country, wanting to know how their state did. How can they find out?
Yes, you can access our report on the Trust for America's Health website at tfah.org. That's tfah.org.
Great. Now, I imagine that your audience for this report is not just public health officials who may know all too well the limitations of their systems. What is your approach to getting people to pay attention to these results, in particular, people who could really do something about them?
Absolutely. Well, I would say one, as you noted earlier, it's seeing the lessons learned from the COVID-19 pandemic and how a public health emergency can have such significant effects across all sectors of society. When we look at the economy, when we look at access to food security, housing, all of these sectors truly having a role, and the reason why it is so important for us to invest in prevention and public health and having a strong emergency preparedness plans in place at federal, state, and local level. So as you noted, while this is certainly a resource to public health officials, this is also a resource as well, in particular, to lawmakers, to other policymakers at the federal, state, and local level to use this actionable data to actually implement the policies, invest in the types of programs and resources that are necessary to strengthen our systems, because emergencies are going to happen. And so the more that we actually invest in our prevention, public health, and emergency preparedness, the better prepared we'll be for that next emergency and assure that, one, we're helping to reduce illness and injury and helping to avoid preventable death.
Dr. Gracia, thanks so much for coming to talk to us about this terrific Ready or Not report.
Thank you, Dr. Sharfstein.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker, Matthew Martin, Spencer Greer, and Holly Cardinale, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media support from Grace Holz Fernandez. Thank you for listening.